What's the music on? What do you think this is, the funeral?
Yo, it's your boy, your host, Ja Lowell. We're back in the building for another episode of the last episode. Now, I know I wasn't here last week. Okay, I skipped out on last week. I had some stuff going on in my personal. I had some neighbors doing work next door. I did do a little Twitch stream. I do stream on Twitch. I'm going to do that a little bit more. So if y'all want to follow me on there, hit me up and we can talk sometimes live about what we've been watching and enjoying. That's twitch.tv/thelastepisodepodcast. Just made it uniform on there, you know, so it should be easy to locate your boy if that's something that you're interested in finding me on that medium. Because I do like playing video games. I play the Avengers video game with that, and that's going to come up a little bit later. Now, we're a few episodes in to the Falcon and the Winter Soldier. Okay, we're not going to take a lot of time dicking around and jump right on in to what we've been seeing. It's a good show, man. It's a good, fun, entertaining show. There's less of a mystery factor in it than there was with WandaVision, obviously. WandaVision, from the very beginning, put us in this space where we were just confused about what was going on. We don't have that problem here. We know exactly what's going on. Sorry about that. Mute my phone. Forgot to do that. We know exactly what's going on here in terms of who the players are and who's who. There's no manipulation on the level of WandaVision going on that we can see, obviously, here. But it's a completely different dynamic, completely different show. And I love that. And I respect that. And that's exactly what I expected. This one, to me, is a little more straightforward in telling just the Falcon and the Winter Soldier story, and what's going on with them together post Endgame, and including action, and there is a bit of mystery that I'll get into, but it's just on a different scale, completely different scale than we had with WandaVision, and like I said, that's fine. That's cool. The first thing I want to say is I hate Lieutenant America, right? I mentioned how I already had a problem with them doing it in the first place at the end of episode 1. But watching 2 and 3, I still don't like him. I don't know if they want me to like him or not, but I don't. I hate him, actually. I really do. And his partner, Lamar Hoskins, he's a casualty of, just being with his, that's his boy. That's what he's supposed to do. He's supposed to ride with his boy, but it's corny. When they landed on the trucks for the fight scene, and when they landed, they, gave each other that, big cringe moment. Anything you got, the black sidekick with a Captain America fake cap, just like you had Sam with real Cap. And it feels great value, to me. I just don't like it. It's not bad in terms of, it's a bad storyline, right? The storyline is fine. It's just that this is the storyline that we're dealing with. And man, it's disrespectful. But it's good. It's a good show. It's good stuff to put in here. It's entertainment. It's making me feel emotions, which I always feel is a good thing. If you're making me feel an emotion, if I care about the character, then you've done something right. you know, because it's not that I don't care about his character at all. I do care about his character. I just hate him. You know what I'm saying? There's only supposed to be one. And then the Lamar Hoskins cat, Battlestar. Really? Really? That name is worse than the Flag Smashers. Let's just be honest, okay? Let's just be honest. I'll tell you who my favorite character is so far, a little later. But Sam and Bucky, the dynamic on screen, it's like they're like two little brothers, and Cap was the big brother that they both looked up to, and you know, he made something special with his life. And you know, these two, they have their issues, you know. They're both good people. I mean, Bucky, he was a good person before the Winter Soldier thing happened to him, and he's trying to be a good person since. So I'll give him the good person moniker. I mean, he was brainwashed. He got a whole 11 words that you can use, or you were able to use to activate him. It was necessary to get him to do those things. So, I mean, deep down, deep down, you know he's a good guy. Okay, we all know that he's a good guy, that he wants to be a good guy, even though he's selfish as hell. He is selfish, and it gets on my nerves. You know, during that second episode, I thought Bucky was going to grab that. I think we all thought he was going to grab a tree when he jumped out of the plane and just slide down. But unfortunately, I guess he missed. That part was funny. Loved it. Let's see. What do I want to really get into here? Because we got two episodes. I know y'all don't need to rehash the second one too much. But the leader of the rebellion, the Flag Smashers, Carly Morgenthau. I don't know, man. You know, it's a rebellion, right? So it's going to be violent. Now, you're branding it as anti-patriotism, but at the same time, it seems like you're fighting because you were displaced when the people came back from the blip. And, you know, it's all about the people who come back from the blip, and you're kind of pushing to the side the people who have been here. Resources aren't what they should be. Some people are got experimented on and are now super soldiers. You got eight of them or whatever running around already. And then there's what, however many more vials that they have, 20. Terrible. Terrible. I mean, what are they going to do with these vials is what I want to know. Are you trying to create more? If you were going to destroy them, you could have done that already, right? So what is your end game? I'm still not really sure what the Flag Smashers' end game is. And we're halfway in. So I want to know exactly what they're going for at this point. You know, it started off as not as violent, but then you're blowing up buildings, and you know, I don't know exactly what you're going for. I wanted to like you, so I'm just kind of confused there. Now look, let's talk about Isaiah a little bit. One of the original super soldiers, black man, underappreciated, experimented on, imprisoned. You know, there's a history in this country of experimentation on black people, and you know, I feel like that was a socially conscious thing that they did, putting that in to this storyline and touching on that. There's still a lot of distrust with it when it comes to the black community and the government because of the history there. And you can look that stuff up yourself. Literally just go on Google and type in blacks experimenting on or something like that, and yeah, it'll come up. You can find it, you can read up on it. And so, you know, to put that in there, I thought was very interesting, and you know, kind of touched a part of me inside. You know, I'm a black man myself, and He is rightfully angry, man. Isaiah is rightfully angry for the way that they treated him, knowing what he did for his country. Like you say, they called him a hero, and that's how you treat your hero. Yeah. But we know how that stuff went back in the day, right? Then they come out, they go outside, and you have the cops swirl up and start harassing Sam when they're both animated, right? Sam and Buck are both animated during the argument, but, you know, Bucky being the one who actually ends up getting arrested because he's the one with the warrant is gravy. It's gravy. But the dynamic that you see there is something that a lot of us black people have experienced or seen firsthand. You're always looking at us as the threat, but we're not going to go. well, I'm not going to get on my soapbox here, okay? So Bucky gets arrested. It's interesting how much pull the government has given Lieutenant America here. You know, he's able to just get Bucky out, not only get him out, but then change the arrangement of his deal in order to be free, you know, his arrangement. So to where he has to see the therapist regularly, and now he doesn't have to do that anymore because Lieutenant America said that we need him. Lots of pull for this guy. That little therapy scene, though, was great that they had at the station. It was hilarious. It was emotional. But let me tell you my feelings about that part is that's where we get the Bucky selfishness from, right? Because in essence, when you start going in on Sam about the shield, and I agree that it was a bad decision for Sam to give up the shield, but when you end it with, if he was wrong about you, then he was wrong about me. It was like, so this is about you. Like, this is less about the shield and more about the image, you know, that you still are struggling with for yourself, you know, who you want to be and who you can still be despite what you've done in your past. I understand that that's going to be something that you're wrestling with and may take a while if maybe you'll never be able to fully get over that. You know, that could be a lifelong internal struggle there. I mean, it was 90 years or however long of you running around and murdering people, albeit against your will. But that's not Sam's issue. That's not his deal. He has no stake in that. And for you to be putting that on him and giving him attitude and all that based on it's selfish. Sam has his own crosses to bear. He has his own feelings and opinions. And that doesn't let Sam off the hook because, like I said, I still think he's wrong, right? People, you did what you think is right, and that's fine. I respect that. It's not like I'm saying, you know, fuck Sam completely. He's trash. Get him out of here. It's not like that, okay? He's not Star-Lord Infinity War status. It's not that at all. But you can do what you think is right and still be wrong. And when you're wrong, you don't get to choose how people react. That's just kind of the thing. The problem at the point in episode 2 when they're talking about it is that he still didn't think that he was wrong at that point. You know, like by episode 3, he was like, yeah, maybe I shouldn't have given it up. And it was like, yeah, no shit. No shit. You shouldn't have given it up. But then he was like, I should destroy it. It was like, all right, man. Like, you're taking baby steps in the right direction. In the right direction, okay? You're veering, but you're taking the steps. Just get on track and stay on track, man. Keep the damn shield. Keep the damn shield. Now, speaking of the shield, Buddy with the Flag Smashers decided he was going to be the shield for his people so they could get away, right? We're talking towards the end of episode 2 when the Flag Smashers are taking some of the supplies that they had, putting them on the plane. Then they hear that the Power Broker's men are on the way, and you have the one Flag Smasher who's like, I'll buy you guys time so you can get away. Right, and it just takes a little bit, right? He could have simply pushed the light pole in their way and stood in front of the cars, hands up, you know, surrendered himself. more than sure that that still would have given them enough time to get away. They're in a damn plane. But he didn't do that. He ran at them charged, masked up, ready for action, you know, knowing that they had all the guns and he's not bulletproof and he doesn't have Kevlar or a shield, an actual shield, and none of that. So he was just going to get lit up. He knew it was over. So that speaks to a mindset. A mindset of capture is not an option. I'll do anything to protect my family. And that's one of the things that kind of makes the group endearing, right? The Flag Smasher group endearing is how they clearly ride for each other so hard that you got a dude who's willing to do something like that. Just go ahead and end it. What we're doing is bigger than any one person, and you guys need to escape, and hey, see you on the other side, right? So that's just an interesting dynamic with the Flag Smashers that I'm still trying to, you know, get around to. But it seems like Carly's going off the deep end there, starting to go off the deep end. The losses of maybe getting to her, you know, that stuff can build up on people. Ask Khaleesi. You know, Daenerys Targaryen, loss can be, I mean, it can change a person. It didn't really take much for them to go see Zemo, for Bucky to convince Sam to go see Zemo. But the escape, though, in episode 3, it was just so smooth and easy, right? It was smooth and easy. The explanation of him walking through it with Sam as it was happening. I liked the presentation of that whole thing. I thought that was cool. Before that, you had the scene where with Lieutenant America and Battlestar in there trying to interrogate, get some information about where they can find the Flag Smashers, and dude wouldn't tell them anything. And you got the guy who spits in his face. He's like, "Do you know who I am?" Hey, listen up.
I'm listening.
If you enjoy the Last Episode Podcast, don't forget to subscribe to the Last Episode Podcast. Like it, share it. Follow me on Twitter, Instagram, at JaLilWill. So you can interact with me. We can talk. You can let me know what you like and don't like about the pod so we can make it as great as possible. You can come here weekly and get your
spirits lifted.
Because you know how we get down. Enjoy the episode. The way my face scrunched up when he said that shit, "Do you know who I am?" Like, no. I don't. Who are you? You're nobody.
I don't even know who you are.
No, go away. You're not the real Cap. You're not
Avengers!
You could never. Do you know who I am?
Don't care. Couldn't tell us.
Get the fuck out of my face. And real villains and people don't spit in a real Cat face. All right, that doesn't happen. They have too much respect for the real Cat for some shit like that. Do you know who I am? The biggest villain so far isn't the Power Broker. It isn't the Flag Smashers. It's Lieutenant America. He's the biggest villain so far. You know, my damn nerves. But Zemo, fun character, man. Fun character. I didn't know he could be so damn cool, right? The coat, even the coat that he rocks when he's walking around. He's an asshole for trying to hit Bucky with the Hydra Warriors right off the bat when he came through. that was fucked up. But he's a cool ass character. He really must be playing a long game, right? I still don't trust him. But he does obviously really hate the idea of super soldiers running around. Now, he's had chances to slip away a couple of times, And not only has he not slipped away and stayed, but he's helped fight. And he got some skills. It's interesting. I don't know his end game yet, but I don't trust that he doesn't have one. He definitely isn't trying to go back to jail. We already know that part. But how long is he going to string this along before he makes a move, makes his move? He has to have one. The purple mask is dope, by the way. I don't know why, but I love it. That shit is dope. When they had to go see Shelby to get the information about, you know, the super soldier serum and who's making it and all that shit. The scene with the drink, man, I know it's something that we were all thinking, where he cuts open the snake for fake smiling tiger Sam, and he's got to drink that shit. I don't know what exactly he put in that drink that he pulled out of the snake, or part of the snake, but somebody let me know if you know, because I tried to look it up, but I couldn't see it, and nobody really knew. There's nothing on there that I could see that gave me that information, and I would really like to know what the fuck that was. Ugh, that shit looked nasty, man. He just had to take it. Shout out to him. So they both had to do something that they didn't want to do to get to Shelby in the first place. Bucky had to fight and whoop ass like the Winter Soldier used to, and Sam had to drink that shit. And to me, they're equal. Sam's might have been worse, actually. You know, even though it's over quickly, you put that in your body, that's not awesome. Okay? It's not the best. Now, who killed Shelby, though? Because Sam almost got away with that damn phone call. He almost got away with the phone call. It had to be right at the end. She had to say his name. But I'm going to need him to be a little quicker. Like, I mean, you call me Smiling Tiger. Are they supposed to know his real name? Maybe his real name's Sam. Shit, maybe it's a nickname. Maybe it's a middle name. You know, shit. Say something. Somebody say something quick to put her off. Don't just look at her all crazy and shit. And then she's like, oh, hell no. Not that she hesitated long before she said, kill him. You can't wait in that business, right? Better safe than sorry. Shoot first, ask questions later. Who the fuck is Sam? You supposed to be? You expect her to be like, all right, Smiling Tiger, see you later. You know, on the phone, talking about Sarah on the phone. He's like, all right, Smiling Tiger, gotta call you back. That way, everybody calls him every single time? I don't know. Anyway. Who did kill Shelby, and then who killed the men outside when they were chasing Buck and Sam? It couldn't have been Sharon. I mean, she just got downstairs too fast, so there has to be another player in here, and that's interesting to me too, right? That's a piece of the mystery that I mentioned earlier. Who's the other player that's clearly lurking around on the outskirts, on the outside, giving protection and shit like that? I don't know. But it was very interesting when they got to the lab that's set up in the shipping containers. That's a hell of a setup. It's very interesting and creative hiding spot. But boy, I tell you what, that shield training ain't no joke, is it? Sharon completely whooped ass, dismantled all those mercenaries coming through. And she got popped a couple of times, but for the most part, she dished it out. All of it. Multiple cats, slick moves. That shield training is no fucking joke. Now, going back to the scientist, right, when Zemo killed him, we talked about Zemo's distaste for super soldiers. Are we believing that he did that because this is the scientist that made that breakthrough? And so he's eliminating him, taking him out. Nobody else knows how to make super soldiers but this guy, so we're going to X him off and not have to worry about that factor. Is that what we're going with? Because, I mean, history and shows tells me usually when you kill somebody that fast, it's because you have a secret. You know, you're trying to hide something. What are you trying to hide? Obviously, we don't know. Is it something? Is it someone you're trying to protect? Got to be cautious. You can't just trust everything we see on the surface. Right? But right after that, right after he does that, if he's trying to protect something, then you might think that he's ready to dip after he does that, but he doesn't, right? The rocket blows up the containers. The fight breaks out. Bucky goes the wrong way. He definitely went the wrong way. If Sam goes out first, you definitely have to just follow Sam. I understand that you said go left first, but Sam went right. So you just kind of need to adjust and roll with me, not, you know, get me isolated. That's not how that's supposed to roll. But they got pinned down for a second there, and lo and behold, who shows up? Zemo, you know, to help bail him out. And then he pulls up in the whip. We know when they could have went separate ways again, but no. He just pulls up in the whip, and he's like, let's roll. And I'm just looking at Zemo like, bruh, what is your game? Why don't you run? Why won't you run? Now, something about that scene that's off to me, right? When they first got to the shipping yard, we didn't see how they got there, right? In terms of who drove what and all that shit. So, but are we saying that Sharon was driven there? Because her having the driver waiting for her, when she left and she gets in the back seat, like the ultimate boss, you know, who's like, feels like you're supposed to be just hiding out and laying low. I mean, to a certain extent, obviously, she sells high end shit, has clients and all that, but that's part of the thing, right? She has resources and connections, so you got a driver waiting for her. When she gets in the car, she says, We have a problem. But why at that point would you have a problem, right? Because you just got information and your boy Sam said he's going to get you your partner so you can come home. So things should be looking up. So what problem are you speaking of? Because you don't really care about the super soldier thing that they're fighting. That has nothing to do with you. You're not trying to fight that battle. Unless maybe you are the power broker, unless Sharon is the power broker. You know, I mean, think about it. How long would she have been here? How long would she have been in Madripoor? Since when did Civil War happen and she stole the shield? You know, it's been that happened obviously before the blip. So it's been over 5 years, 6-7 years. That's definitely enough time to establish yourself as a big time player if you know you're doing shit, making the right moves and all of that. So very interesting. That's something that needs to be kept an eye on. You need to keep an eye on Sharon. As I know some of you are already excited about keeping an eye on Sharon, okay? So I'm going to need you to relax, okay? Though she is a beautiful woman, she might not be very trustworthy right now. We know how it goes, too, when you feel betrayed by your country or your country's coming after you put in so many years of service, even though you did something you weren't supposed to do. You know, it just feels, you got to make a way. And sometimes it gets crazy, and I'm thinking that we might have some shit that's going to come out later that's going to have us like, hey, man, what in the fuck? What in the fuck? And you know I don't trust. You know I don't trust. I told you. Yeah, I've been watching S.H.I.E.L.D. with the babe. she hasn't seen S.H.I.E.L.D. before, and so I'm putting her on, and we're going back through. You know, I mean, at this point, I've seen S.H.I.E.L.D. like 5 times, maybe more. I've rewatched the series. I love it so much. And we just got to the part where Ward, you know, flipped. Like, literally, just last night, we got to that episode. And we're watching, and Garrett, if you've seen it, you know how it goes. Garrett, he's a traitor, man. And that shit came out with Hydra, you know, it coincided, the episode coincided with the release of the Captain America Winter Soldier, when Hydra, you know, came out and revealed themselves and shit. And so that's basically what was happening in the episode as well. Hydra revealing itself, and you find out, you know, who's who on what side. And, you know, John Garrett is a Hydra agent. And she was like, you know, the babe, she was like, what the hell? She was like, I did not see that coming. It's like, nobody saw it coming. I've talked to a lot of people about the show. Nobody saw it coming. But that wasn't it, you know. Then the Ward betrayal happened at the very, very end of the episode, and she was just like, what the fuck? Yeah, what the fuck? What the fuck is right? And think about it like this, right? It's season one. So you may think to yourself, it was still season one. How deep in with Ward were you actually? Well, it was the 17th episode of season one. Consider the fact that some seasons only have 8 episodes a pop. If it was like that, then you got through 2 seasons of Ward, essentially. 16 episodes is a lot, you know, before this betrayal happened. That's time. That's definitely time. Enough to establish a feeling about a person, a character. Because, man, he did a great job. Can't trust the motherfucker, though. He's the main person who, like, you know, you go back and you watch the early episodes too, and you see how much he rides for the team, you know, how into it he is, the shit that he says and does. He threw himself out of a plane, you know, to save one of the team members, you know. He did every and anything you could think of as a specialist to protect his team, that made you think that he was all in, and it was all a fucking lie. Crazy, man. Hold on. My voice keeps getting me. I don't know what that is. But listen, let's go back to the fucking Winter Soldier. I'm almost done with that. Only have like another thought or two on that. Just Ayo. Ayo showing up at the end was a nice, pleasant surprise. I expected the Wakandans to have a problem with Zemo being out, but I didn't expect him to show up that damn fast. I mean, it's been one damn episode. They're already there to collect. You know they have a long memory. They don't just let shit slide when you wrong them. Claw did what he did. Killed Wakanda and stole from them decades ago or whatever. And they were still on his ass looking for him. You think they weren't going to be monitoring Zemo and seeing how he's being treated, if he's actually locked up like he's supposed to be? You killed King T'Chaka. You will never be able to just live your life without looking over your shoulder if you are not in prison. Even if you are in prison, then, you know, never, ever, 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 ever. But that was cool that she showed up. It's unfortunate that the people didn't realize that that wasn't Okoye. Even if you didn't remember or know Ayo's name herself, you should know that it's not Okoye. She's different. Okoye was actually trending on Twitter because people thought it was Okoye. Come on, be better. be better. The new trailer for Black Widow dropped. Looks good, man. Looks good. Looks deep and real. You know, there's a dynamic at play, it feels like, of standards and expectations versus personal desire and inner self of who you are as a person and, you know, how you see yourself and all that stuff, you know. So there's, if you watch the trailer, it speaks to it a little bit. You see why I say that. So it does feel like it's going to be a little deeper, which I'm cool with. The bad guy that we see in the trailer, Taskmaster, was not familiar with Taskmaster until the Marvel Avengers video game, actually. You know, I told you guys before. Excuse me. You know, I told you guys before. I wasn't into the, you know, comments and all that stuff, so I don't know everything. I wasn't familiar with Taskmaster, but I fought him a couple of times in the goddamn Avengers video game. So now he's going to be in the movie, and it's very interesting. I don't have any expectations for how he's supposed to be, act, or anything like that, and I prefer it that way, because that means if I don't have expectations, you can't let me down, you know, because I have some preconceived notion of how I think he should be. I'm going to take him how you present him, and we're going to judge him strictly on that. Is it good or is it bad? That's all that matters to me when it comes to movies and shows. Is it good or is it bad? All the canon shit, you know, and following the storyline. The canon only matters to me if we're tying the movies together with movies, shows with shows, shows to movies, movies to shows. It doesn't matter to me when we're talking about comics and all that other shit that came before the MCU really started getting in its bag on screen, you know? So, I mean, that's where I am. That's where I stand. Also, The Bad Batch is a Star Wars little cartoon animated series that's coming out May 4th. May the 4th be with you. You know how that goes. I will be watching that, and I will be discussing it. Right now, I'm trying to catch up on Clone Wars. I'm behind on Clone Wars. I've seen most of the other, pretty much all the other Star Wars stuff. Except like the Solo movie. I still have to watch that one, but I'll be doing the pods on those as well when it drops. We only have 3 more episodes of Falcon and the Winter Soldier, and then we're going to be off from Marvel for a month, a little over a month, before Loki drops on the 11th of June. And I'm very excited about Loki. Very, very excited about Loki, but we're going to have to wait a little while for that one. Though it's nothing compared to how we have been waiting before we even got WandaVision. So I'm not really tripping over a month, especially because you're going to give me some Star Wars content in the meantime. You know, I'm all about that. I love the Star Wars stuff. I've been waiting for it as well. I don't love it as much as I love Marvel, but I love it. You know, I love Marvel. You know what I'm saying? I love it. Can't wait. It's going to be fun. It's been fun. It's been a great pod today. I think. You tell me. I don't know. Find me on Twitter. Leave a review. Don't forget to subscribe. Tell your friends about me. Tell them about the pod. But hit your boy up. You already know where to find me. I said it before. At JaLilWill. On Twitter and Instagram. Remember, if you want to hit up the Twitch, that's twitch.tv/thelastepisodepodcast. I'll be back again next week to talk about episode 4 after we peep that motherfucker. And it's going to be a great time, just like it always is. So, for now, you know how we do.
Sun's getting real low.
And we out.